The Black Death in Europe and Eurasia was the most infamous tragedy in the 14th century. The devastating plague resulted in the deaths of around 200 million people. Popular culture's constant reference to this time period may give the impression that the whole world was experiencing this dark era. But ironically, while Europe was being decimated by disease, parts of the African continent were experiencing a golden age. What up, African world? It's Homeseem here, and I'm back at it with another video of African history, culture, and worldview. And as always, if you want to support the Homeseem, you can do so on patreon.com. Also, go to afrographics.com, a website where you can find unique illustrative infographics summarizing African history. All links in the description box below. The Black Death is said to have peaked in Europe around 1347 to 1351, so we'll be focusing on African history around the mid-14th century. This period is also considered by many to be part of the Dark Ages. Unfortunately for us in the African diaspora, Eurocentric schooling leaves our children with the impression that the Dark Ages essentially apply to the world, and of course, this couldn't be further from the truth. Let's begin in North Africa. The Mamluk Sultanate made Cairo its capital, and under Mamluk rule, the city prospered. In the year 1340, near the peak years of the Black Death, the inhabitants of Cairo grew to about 500,000 people, making it the largest city on three continents. As the home of Al-Azhar University, Cairo had also become the main seat of learning in the Islamic world. The city went on to position itself to profit from the spice trade from Asia to the Mediterranean, becoming an economic gem in North Africa. In this period, many of Cairo's architectural masterpieces were being built. Ironically, some of the plague did affect the city of Cairo, largely due to its close proximity to southern Europe and Eurasia. In Central Africa, further to the south, the Bakongo people were just beginning to establish their kingdom. Congo became one of the most powerful kingdoms in Central Africa, later centering their capital at Mbanza, Congo. Along the eastern coast, popularly known as the Swahili coast, the Tanzanian city of Kilwa began to come into its own as it became the main transshipment point for gold coming from inner Africa at Great Zimbabwe. As the Black Death continued to ravage Europe, the people in Kilwa became more prosperous. They built large houses of coral rag and lime mortar, produced cloth to trade with their neighbors, minted their own coins, and imported increasing quantities of Persian and Chinese pottery. Kilwa most certainly enjoyed its golden era, and the Swahili city reached its greatest prosperity during the mid-14th century. Also in East Africa, Ethiopia was beginning to solidify its religious identity. Even though Islam was on the rise, Christianity had been in existence in Ethiopia for quite some time, and so this naturally caused some conflict. During the Black Death, Muslim Ethiopia began a huge power struggle with Christian Ethiopia, and the dominant religious identity for generations to come was going to be determined through this struggle. In the mid-14th century, a Muslim-led combined army of Afar and Somali troops launched three successive assaults against the Christian Ethiopian king, Amda Sion, and his forces. All of the Muslim attempts failed, and the Muslims were forced to retreat back into their region, where they were pursued and eventually conquered by Amda and his army. Christian Ethiopia had succeeded in the first phase of religious struggle for that region. In West Africa, the Yoruba city of Ele-Ife reached its peak during the Black Death. Ele-Ife was regarded as the oldest city and the center of the Yoruba people. It became the most dominant Yoruba city, and its rulers were accorded preeminence within the Ebi system. The Ebi system conceptualized the relations between the elites of various Yoruba cities as the equivalent of sibling relations within a family, with Ele-Ife as the parent. In addition to being the traditional home of the ruling class of traditional Yoruba society, Ele-Ife was very important as a point of dissemination for major forms of West African art. In particular, sculptures of bust and other naturalistic figures were created in Ele-Ife, and a similar style of artwork was adopted by neighboring peoples, especially the Edo of Benin. The Yoruba were heavily involved in many traditional crafts and industries. These included brass and ironworking, but the most noteworthy was the textile production. Yoruba women were particularly noted for the production of finely patterned cloth. this traditional production would continue into the 20th century. It should also be noted that women in general figured very prominently in the commercial world, and they were often the largest and most successful merchants in the markets. Also in the West, the Mali Empire, arguably the most powerful West African state, was still in its golden age, even after the death of Mansa Musa. In about 1351, during the reign of Mansa Suleiman, Mali was reportedly at its safest and at its peak militarily. Mali was able to expand its immense influence and extend its borders. The Mandinka collectively became a political and economic powerhouse in the Western Sudan. When Ibn Battuta arrived at Mali in July 1352, he found a thriving civilization on par with virtually anything in the Muslim or Christian world. Ibn Battuta went on to tell us that the people of Mali are seldom unjust and have greater abhorrence of injustice than any other people. Their sultan shows no mercy to anyone who is guilty of the least act of it. There is complete security in their country. Neither traveler nor inhabitant in it has anything to fear from robbers or men of violence. Well, I'm all out, guys. If you like these videos and want to help out in its continued production, please consider supporting the home team on patreon.com. The link is in the description box below. Know thyself. Remember your ancestors. Peace.